Speaker, I would like to begin by recognizing that we are, as we are every day in this House, on the ancestral land of the Algonquin people.
Last September, I spoke at the United Nations before delegations from all around the world. I spoke to them about the hard truths about Canada's long and complex relationship with First Nations, Inuit, and the Métis. I spoke about the colonial approach that led to the Indian Act, a discriminatory and paternalistic law.
A colonial approach that systematically ignored the history of the Métis Nation and denied its people their rights, and that, in the name of Canadian sovereignty, forced the relocation of entire Inuit communities, starving individuals, uprooting families, and causing generations of harm.
The events that I spoke about are, I'm sure, very well known by all members of this House. But what is remarkable, Mr. Speaker, is how much Canadians are also aware of these tragic events.
I just finished a series of town hall visits in communities all across Canada. And everywhere I went, there was at least one person who wanted to know what our government is doing to combat racism, to help advance reconciliation, to improve the quality of life for Indigenous peoples. There were questions about fishing rights, land claims, and pipeline approvals. Questions about the national inquiry into missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls, about clean water, and about the alarming number of Indigenous children in foster care. These were thoughtful questions, Mr. Speaker. And it was immediately clear, every time these kinds of questions were asked, the room leaned in to hear. This was, in part, a show of support for the people who stood up and asked some tough questions. But it was also a signal that these are questions that Canadians want answered. Questions that strike right at the heart of who we are and what kind of country we want to be. One of those questions is how we, as a government, recognize and implement the rights of Indigenous peoples. We've seen those questions grow in number and intensity in just these past few days, as more and more Canadians come to grips with the facts that we have so much more work to do. More work to push back against the systemic racism that is the lived reality for so many Indigenous peoples. More work to deal with the fact that too many feel and fear that our country and its institutions will never deliver the fairness, justice, and real reconciliation that Indigenous peoples deserve. There is also reason to be hopeful, Mr. Speaker. Yesterday, I had the honour of spending some time with Colton Bushy's family, with his mom Debbie, cousin Jade, and Uncle Alvin. And through all their grief and anger and frustration, their focus was not on themselves and the tragedy they just endured, but on how we must work together to make the system and our institutions better. Better for Indigenous youth, for Indigenous families, and for all Canadians. We have a responsibility to do better, to be better, to do our best to make sure that no family has to endure what they went through. Mr. Speaker, the criminal justice system is just one place in which reforms are urgently needed. Reforms are needed to ensure that, among other things, Indigenous peoples might once again have confidence in a system that has failed them all too often in the past. That is why we will bring forward broad-based, concrete reforms to the criminal justice system, including changes to how juries are selected.
It's clear, Mr. Speaker, that Indigenous peoples and all Canadians know that the time has come for real change. At the same time, some view our government's ambitious commitments with a certain amount of suspicion. And if you consider the way that things have been handled in the past, it's difficult to say honestly that that suspicion is not justified. After all, it's not as though we were the first government to recognize the need to make change and to promise that we would do things differently. It's been more than 20 years since the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples called for the recognition of Aboriginal peoples as self-governing nations with a unique place in Canada. More than 30 years have passed since the Penner Report and the First Minister's Conferences on the Rights of Aboriginal Peoples.
Last year marked 35 years since Aboriginal and treaty rights were recognized and affirmed through Section 35 of the Constitution Act. You might recall, Mr. Speaker, that the government of the day, led by my father, did not intend to include these rights at the outset. It was the outspoken advocacy of First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples, supported by non-Indigenous Canadians, that forced that government to reconsider. Imagine what that must have felt like, Mr. Speaker. You have fought so long, so hard against colonialism, rallying your communities, reaching out to Canadians, riding the Constitution Express, and in the end, to finally be recognized and included, to see your rights enshrined and protected in the foundational document upon which Canada's democracy rests. Now imagine the mounting disappointment, the all too unsurprising and familiar heartache, and the rising tide of anger when governments that had promised so much did so little to keep their word. You see, Mr. Speaker, the challenge, then as now, is that while Section 35 recognizes and affirms Aboriginal and treaty rights, those rights have not been implemented by our governments. The work to give life to Section 35 was supposed to be done together with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples. And while there has been some success, progress has not been sustained nor significant. And so, over time, it too often fell to the courts to pick up the pieces and fill in the gaps. More precisely, instead of outright recognizing and affirming Indigenous rights, as we promised we would, Indigenous peoples were forced to prove, time and time again, through costly and drawn-out court challenges, that their rights existed, must be recognized and implemented.
Indigenous peoples, like all Canadians, know that this needs to change. And we know it too. So that's why we have been working hard for 2 years to renew the relationship that we have with Indigenous peoples, a relationship founded on the recognition of rights, on respect, on cooperation, and on partnership. We are on the right track.
We endorsed the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples without qualification, and committed to its full implementation, including with government support for Bill C-262. We engaged in new recognition of rights and self-determination negotiations, where the government and Indigenous peoples work together on the priorities Indigenous partners say are necessary to advance their vision of self-determination. We signed agreements with First Nations, Inuit, and the Métis Nation outlining how we will work together to identify each community's distinct priorities and how we will work together to develop solutions. We established a working group of ministers to review our federal laws, policies, and operational practices to ensure that the Crown is meeting its constitutional obligations and adhering to international human rights standards, including the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. To guide the work of decolonizing Canadian laws and policies, we adopted principles respecting Canada's relationship with Indigenous peoples.
Pour préserver, protéger et revitaliser les langues autochtones, to preserve, protect, and revitalize Indigenous languages, we are working with Indigenous partners jointly to develop a First Nations, Inuit, and Métis Language Act. We've made changes to recognize Aboriginal rights and traditional knowledge while making more space for Indigenous peoples when there are developments in their communities.
These efforts are an important start, Mr. Speaker, but they are just a start. To truly renew the relationship between Canada and Indigenous peoples, not just for today, but for the next 150 years and beyond, we need a comprehensive and far-reaching approach. We need a government-wide shift in how we do things. We need to both recognize and implement Indigenous rights, because the truth is, Mr. Speaker, until we get this part right, we won't have lasting success on the concrete outcomes that we know mean so much to everyone. Indigenous peoples in Canada should be able to drink the water that comes out of their taps. They should be able to go to sleep in homes that are safe and not overcrowded. Indigenous children should be able to stay with their families and communities where they are known and loved. And Indigenous youth should not grow up surrounded by the things that place them at elevated risk for suicide, things like poverty, abuse, and limited access to a good education and good health care. All of these things demand real, positive action, action that must include and be grounded in the full recognition and implementation of Indigenous rights. We need to get to a place where Indigenous peoples in Canada are in control of their own destiny, making their own decisions about their future. And so, today, I am pleased to announce that the government will develop, in full partnership with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people, a new recognition and implementation of Indigenous rights framework that will include new ways to recognize and implement Indigenous rights. This will include new recognition and implementation of rights legislation. Going forward, recognition of rights will guide all government interactions with Indigenous peoples. The contents of the framework that we build together will be determined through a national engagement led by the Minister of Crown, Indigenous Relations and Northern Affairs, with support from the Minister of Justice. Mais plutôt,
earlier, I mentioned several reports, studies, in consultations that were conducted in the past. I know that some people will see any future consultation as just another step that will slow down and hinder the movement towards self-government for Indigenous peoples. But let me be clear, Mr. Speaker. Even if our solutions are responsible, well-intentioned, and well thought out, a solution that comes only from Ottawa simply won't be sufficient. We understand that Indigenous peoples are eager to undertake the significant work of rebuilding their nations and their institutions themselves. As a government, our job is to support, stand beside, and work in partnership with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people in order to establish a framework and give them the tools that they need to trace their own path together with all Canadians.
We'll also be engaging the provinces and territories and non-Indigenous Canadians, people from civil society, from industry and the business community, and the public at large, because all can have a stake in getting this right. While the results of this engagement will guide what the final framework looks like, we believe that, as a starting point, it should include new legislation and policy that would make the recognition and implementation of rights the basis for all relations between Indigenous peoples and the federal government moving forward. This framework gives us the opportunity to build new mechanisms to recognize Indigenous governments and ensure rigorous, full, and meaningful implementation of treaties and other agreements. With this framework, we have a chance to develop new tools to support the rebuilding of Indigenous communities, nations, and governments, and advance self-determination, including the inherent right of self-government. This framework could establish new ways to resolve disputes so that collaboration becomes the new standard and conflict the exception rather than the rule. By including tools that oblige the federal government to be more transparent and accountable, we can build greater trust between Indigenous peoples and government. Enfin, grâce à ce nouveau cadre,
with this new framework, we will better align Canadian laws and policies with the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples that this government unreservedly supports. We believe that a framework with these measures will finally meet many of the recommendations brought forward by the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples and the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, as well as those of many studies and reports that have been conducted over the years.
Some may worry that this ambitious approach may require reopening the Constitution. Well, that is not true. In fact, we are finally fully embracing and giving life to the existing Section 35 of the Constitution. And so we'll replace policies like the Comprehensive Land Claims Policy and the Inherent Right to Self-Government Policy with new and better approaches that respect the distinctions between First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples. This will give greater confidence and certainty to everyone involved. The federal government's absence over generations in recognizing and implementing Indigenous rights has resulted in social and economic exclusion, uncertainty, and litigation. When our shared focus should have always been on creating prosperity and opportunity for everyone. Better opportunities for Indigenous peoples and certainty for Indigenous youth are precisely what we hope to achieve through this framework. Engagement will continue throughout the spring, but it is our firm intention to have the framework introduced later this year and implemented before the next election.
This work will involve not only the government, but also this Parliament. There will be committee work. There will be witnesses to hear. There will be vigorous debate in both houses. The history of the relationship between Canada and Aboriginal peoples transcends all governments, Mr. Speaker. The Indian Act was adopted in this House, just as Section 35 was. And now, as a Parliament, we have an opportunity, and above all the responsibility, to finally implement Section 35. Mr. Speaker, we all know that we cannot erase the past. We know that we cannot regain what has been lost. What we can do, what we must do, is commit to being better, to doing better.
Pour commencer, to begin with, ce que la loi constitutionnelle nous oblige à faire depuis presque 40 ans.
What the Constitution should have been making us do for 40 years.
To do away with legislation and policies built to serve colonial interests. We will work together as we follow through on our commitments to build a new and better relationship. Mr. Speaker, Indigenous Canadians and all Canadians are ready for change, ready for a new relationship based on recognition, rights, respect, cooperation, and partnership. With a recognition and implementation of rights framework, we can build that new relationship together. It won't be easy, Mr. Speaker. Nothing worth doing ever is. And it will be worth it. It will be worth it because we will have taken more steps towards righting historical wrongs. It will be worth it because we will have replaced apathy with action, ignorance with understanding, and conflict with respect. We will have laid the foundation for real and lasting change, the kind of change that can only come when we fully recognize and implement Indigenous rights. Together, we will take concrete action to build a better future, a better Canada for Indigenous peoples and for all Canadians. Merci.
Thank you.